Hello and welcome, and back to the banished lands we go. And I realize that my title for this video was a horrible, awful pun, and I'm so sorry. But if you have read Ruin by John Gwynne, you know that saying that this book emotionally ruined me is not that far of a stretch. It has some tear-jerking, heartbreaking moments, okay? If you have not read it, you should probably save this video to watch later because, spoilers, I'm talking in-depth about characters here, so you're gonna wanna already know what happens. So this video is actually going to be characters from Ruin Part 1, and in the second part of the video, I'll go over whatever characters I don't cover here. So, let's start with Corbin, shall we? But actually, if we're starting with Corbin, we also have to start with Michael, because Michael is a liar, liar, pants on fire. And to talk about Corbin's struggle and character arc for this book, we kind of need to bring up what Michael did to him and to everyone, because everyone believes Michael. They don't know that the prophecy was from Michael. They know that it's super old, from the depths of time. Everyone believes this prophecy about the bright star and the black sun, even Azeroth himself. And we can see that even though Corbin is not too fond of believing that he is actually the bright star, he's starting to accept it and starting to embrace it, and then, oh boy, but wait, back to the beginning. Okay, and in the beginning of Ruin, Corbin is getting attacked by some Kadoshim. He's nearly overcome with fear, but then he remembers what they did to his mother, and his fear quickly turns to hatred. And quoting from the Bible, there is a time or a season for everything. And I'm gonna say that the time to hate is to hate evil. And memories of his mother gain him some courage here at the start of this book. So we also see Michael pushing Corbin towards what Michael thinks he should do. Now, to Corbin, this seems like, well, Michael is the emissary of Elion, I'm the avatar of Elion, so while Michael probably knows what he should do, Corbin knows where his heart is, and his heart is with Idana. He swore an oath to her. He is a man who fulfills his oaths. That is what he desires to do. This causes a little friction between him and Michael, because Michael, which we don't know yet, wrote in the prophecy that he needs to go to Drassel. And I kind of think Michael forgot all those centuries ago when he wrote this, that when someone came to fulfill the prophecy, that he would choose to fulfill the prophecy, that he would be dealing with a real human with his own wants and desires, with his with a mind of his own, and he could decide to look at Michael and say, sorry, Michael, I'm doing this. I'm the bright star, I decide. Michael was not prepared for that. He was prepared for someone to say, okay, Michael, lead me. Also, Corbin feeling so strongly about fulfilling his oath to Idana is something that his parents instilled in him as a young man. If you swear an oath, you fulfill it. And what I see from Corbin is that he cares more about what his parents taught him than about what Michael says Elion wants from him. And I see that as being Corbin caring more about what his parents thought than what this far-off god that he's never seen thinks. He's faithful to his god, but I would almost say more faithful to his family. Also, if you're an angel like Michael is, it's really easy to see the big picture stuff. We are good. Azeroth and Kadoshim are evil. Our job is to defeat evil. Corbin sees the short-term, very personal decisions that he has to make that will affect other people that he loves. Speaking of which, he's starting to really see the difference between when you go into a battle and you're just one of the soldiers and you're going in together versus having to be the one that leads them and tells them to go into battle. He's not used to this type of authority yet. But everyone with him is willing to listen to him and go with him. They are all willing to follow him. All of his followers, which I guess they now are, they all respect him. And what has Corbin done to earn their respect besides just be the bright star? He has the title, he has the backing of Michael, and honestly, what's special about Corbin? what makes him better than any other young man that Michael could have chosen. I kind of think Michael got lucky having someone like Corbin be the guy to fulfill his prophecy. Sure, he's the chosen one, if we still want to call him that, knowing what we know at the end. He gets special training from Gar, which none of the other young men back in his home got. Those are kind of like outside sources affecting him. I think what makes him special is more what's on the inside. His battle cry, truth and courage. He exemplifies those traits. He's courageous, kind, merciful, strong, a great warrior. All the things that a hero should be. Michael's probably breathing a sigh of relief. Whew, I got a good guy here. Speaking of good guy, bad guy, we're told the Ben Elim are good and the Kadoshim are evil. Michael's basically a false prophet. How do you feel about that? Does that make him bad? Do the ends justify the means? He's trying to do good, but he lied. He's taking all these people into a battle that was never meant to be. He's a manipulator. Should we still see him as being so good just because of what he is? A false prophet with good intentions can be just as harmful as someone who's already evil. I found it very interesting that for someone who is supposedly chosen by God, Corbin doesn't seem very religious. I don't see him showing much devotion to his God. Corbin's devotion and passion is for the people that he cares about. And I felt like the hero chosen by God should have said a little prayer, you know, help me, Elyon, bless my sword, whatever, some little thing when he goes into fight Sumer, however that said, Sumer, I don't know. When he goes into this battle, he defies Michael, who's trying to tell him not to, the supposed messenger of God. He says no prayer to Elyon, the actual God. He fights for those who love him. And let me tell you, they really love him after this fight. If he hadn't proven by this point that he was worthy of being the chosen one, boy, has he proved himself now. And seriously, I wish authors would stop writing some kind of manufactured romance. There is no chemistry between Corbin and Coraline. I'm not even sure I can tell you what they like about each other. I'm not sure why they like each other. If that never turns into anything in the next book, I will be fine with it. I would rather see a real love grow out of maybe a friendship or common interests, maybe more of a common interest than just fighting. I don't know. Not the best romance in the book. And so at the end of this book, Corbin is really fulfilling his role. He's the hero, but oh boy, used, manipulated, not happy with Michael at this point, and he goes off to be alone to try to think things through. He misses the battle. He gets separated from Storm, who's just left at the end. And okay, that's one of the parts that made me cry, of course. Not the part where she's howling, but the part where she stops howling. If you've read Wrath, no spoilers, please, but she better be alive in the next book, okay? Do not tell me in the comments if she is or not. Okay, next character. Speaking of chemistry and actual good romance, one of my favorite romances ever now is Mackin and Fidele, which I wanted to pronounce Macquin and Fidel, and then I listened to the audiobook and I'm pretty much wrong about every name ever. Mackin and Fidele are much nicer sounding. And I'm pretty sure now Mackin is one of my favorite characters ever. I have never wanted so badly for someone to stay alive. And if Mr. Gwynne is aware of how he makes us feel about this guy, he sure takes us through the emotional turmoil by putting Mackin into so many situations where he could die, he probably should die, and then, oh my gosh, he's alive still. Whew. And part of what I loved about the romance between him and Fidele was that it was so unnecessary. I did not need a romance between them. When they go off together and he chooses to be faithful to her, to stay with her and protect her, that was enough for me. She shows her strength, she shows her bravery and courage, and if they came out of that with a mutual respect and friendship, That would have been fine. The fact that their mutual respect, the fact that they went through together what they did, and the fact that they just kind of slowly grew together to count on each other, to be faithful to each other, to deeply love each other, that was just such a natural progression. It felt right. And that's what I call chemistry in a romance. And when Makin comes back from the Bridge of Swords, oh, the other scene that made me cry. I forgot that I cried when I read it until I just started to try to talk about it. When he's on the Bridge of Swords, he sees people that he desires to be with, but he comes back. He has two main reasons: love and revenge. Like Wesley from The Princess Bride. Again, please no spoilers for Wrath, but I am in love with the Makin Fidelay love story. I want them to be together forever. I want them both to live. I want them to go retire off happily somewhere where there's no pirates or magic or anything. Please let them live happily ever after. Okay, I also hate how Fidelay is treated by her son. Hate it. I was already starting to really dislike Nathair, but the way he treats his mommy makes me so mad. He treats her like a crazy old lady, puts her in prison, will not believe her, and he's kind of now on opposite sides morally from her. I don't know what he's going to do. I don't know if Nathair and Fidelay can be resolved to each other. I think Fidelay is a compassionate and loving mother and would forgive him. I don't know what Nathair would do. Nathair is not in this video. He will be in part two, so I will not go there, but I am angry at that boy. And then they escape, hopefully to safety. I don't know. We'll see in book four, won't we? Okay, I don't have a ton to say about Gar and Tuchel, except that their relationship is, again, one of the best ones in the book. Tuchel's pride and love for his son is just amazing and inspiring. Tuchel has unwavering faith. He would have believed in Corbin anyway because of his own personal beliefs. He is devoted to his religion, unlike Corbin himself. But then as he gets to know Corbin, he's able to like and respect Corbin for the person that Corbin is. He's so proud of Gar for the way Gar watched over Corbin and helped teach him. Gar is spending some time grieving for Corbin's mom, and he's probably even more devoted now to watching over Corbin now that he has no parents. Oh man, Corbin and Gar are both orphans now, aren't they? Can Gar please live? This is one of the few series I've read where I don't know who's going to live in the end, and that's a little bit stressful. I will spare a short minute for the ladies. I'm not sure the ladies got as much character development as they could have, and I did watch an interview with John Gwynne where he said that in some future books that he's writing, he's focusing a little more on female characters. Cool, haven't read them yet. I plan to in the future. But I love that every woman in this series is so strong, and not like girl power strong, but like deep strength, courage, bravery, all the things that a strong warrior should have. The strong women don't seem manly. They still seem feminine. They seem like real women. So whereas some authors I'm kind of mad about the way they try to write women or strong women, I think John Gwynne must have some really good strong women in his life to write them so well. And if that gets better in future books, I am excited to read them. I'm a little worried that Brina is gonna have some kind of power trip with this book that she has. We'll see. But I love how she took in Cohen. Cohen was feeling a little useless. She needed something to do, some kind of job. She's not a warrior. She was not a healer yet, but she's learning. And Brina taking her in under her wing and saying, come learn from me, be my apprentice, just lifted Cohen up, gave her purpose, gave her something to focus her time on, and probably a bit of a relief to Cohen. She was feeling a little lost, and here comes Brina saying, come on with me, I'll teach ya. And finally, the last character that I'm going to talk about is Camlin. I have liked Camlin since day one. More than liked, I rooted for him. He starts out as this brigand. Not really what you would call a bad guy. The characters here, there's a lot of gray in these books. I think that's good. I think you need the characters to be able to decide for themselves what kind of choices they'll make. And Camlin wants to be better. He wants to do better. He sees that he can be a protector, maybe even a hero. He would never consider himself a hero, but talk to the people he saves. They might have a different story, especially with Meg. Ugh, Meg is so cute. Meg would probably describe him as a hero. And while he doesn't think that much of himself, he does know that Cohen and Adana, they inspire him to be better and do better. This is another character that I really hope lives and gets a good ending. We'll see. So I do have a video about Corbin from book one, Malice. I have zero videos from Valor because I read this during my year that I took off from YouTube. I will probably eventually get back to it. I'll probably have to reread it to remember what goes on in this book. But if you enjoyed this video, you can come back later for part two, where I talk about the other characters, the baddies, if you will. Subscribe for more fantasy character studies and other book content, and I'll see you next time. Bye.